everyone. It is November 23rd at 5:30 exactly. Welcome to the Hadley School Committee meeting. Okay, first thing we have is approval of minutes of the November 2nd minutes. Does anyone like to give a motion?
Perhaps someone who is there.
Motion to approve the minutes.
All right. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do we have any adjustments to the agenda?
We may. I just want to ask, here's one thing I didn't check. We're expecting Jenny Moss for the award. Do you think they know which door? Do they know which room? And that's not on you, that's on me. We confirm the time.
I'll check to make sure. I was going to go out and check to make sure that the door is open.
Okay.
Yep, all set.
Ta-da! Fantastic.
Good job, Brian.
Yeah. Nicely done, Mr. Beck.
Yeah. All right. Just in time. The first thing on our agenda.
Well, you can
step up.
Front row.
Presentation.
Okay. What are we doing? The Mass Certificate of Academic Excellence?
That is correct. So this evening, I am privileged to present to Jenny Moss, the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents Certificate for Academic Excellence. And this award, because of the size of our district, we select one student each year to be given this award. And the criteria for the award, certainly academic achievement is considered, but also contribution to one's school community, leadership skills, and the recommendation of the faculty. And I know that Mr. Beck will want to say some things, but I personally also want to say to your parents, as I said to you at open house, your daughter is simply delightful. I mean, not only is she accomplished academically, she is a tremendous leader. I've had the privilege of going to school council meetings here at Hopkins Academy, and she's a thoughtful contributor. She's funny as all get out. She's really funny. She's an exceptional actress. I remember that last year from 12 Angry Jurors, and I took her aside and said, she did such a good job in every way, just capturing that character, your physical, the voice, everything. In all things that you endeavor to do, you do so well, and you're just remarkable, so congratulations.
And so Jenny, just from a personal perspective, since the time that I've been here as a principal, that you've been on the school council, and the school has gone through an enormous amount of change with turnover and staff, and we've had to make some changes through the school council, and we've had a ton of conversations over the years, and I'm looking forward to the remainder of your senior year, because losing you as an advisor after this year is going to be very difficult, so I appreciate your service on the council. Thank you very much.
Congratulations. Do you want to give a speech?
Go for it.
I guess all sure. I have to say is thank you so much. I feel so honored to be given this. So thank you to everyone here.
You're welcome.
And what are your plans for next year?
Well, I just sent in my application to UMass Amherst. And
nice.
If I get in and get the major I would like, I'll hopefully be in the Eisenberg School of Management studying marketing.
Nice, good luck.
Fantastic.
That's awesome.
If you're looking for a project, you can always help us drive up our school choice numbers. We're very interested to have you come back. Well, congratulations again, Tony. It's really a pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Sure. Glad to be here.
So now we go to educating English language learners.
Yes, more.
I'm so glad it's a big PowerPoint because the printout was...
Yes.
Small.
Well, the community has the handouts on our district website. I'm going to scoot right over here. So I'm really excited to show these data to the school committee and to the community at large. I apologize for having my back to most of the folks out here. But I was digging through our access data, and this overview will explain to the community and the school committee what access is. But I was digging through the test data, that the test that we use, the annual testing for our students who are classified as English language learners. And I was so impressed, jaw-dropping impressed at the outcomes for our students. And you'll certainly see that as we go through the presentation. I want to... How about
move the computer forward?
I'd like to, sorry about that, I don't want to be notified of that.
Randomly.
There we go. Let's try that again. Oh, bother. Well, So an overview of what this is, what are we talking about when we talk about English language learners? There are three big buckets when we think of our English language learner program. One is the curriculum and the standards, and that's referred to as WIDA, and that stands for World Class Instructional Design and Assessment. So WIDA refers to our curriculum and standards. The instruction that we provide is sheltered English immersion, and when we say English as a second language or ESL instruction, and the assessment we give is called ACCESS. English language learners also participate in MCAS, but they have their own test of English language development, and that stands for, you can see, Assessing Comprehension and Communication in English State to State. And so in general, that's a lot to read, but it's part of a multi-state consortium, similar to what this state did with PARC. So it's part of a multi-state consortium. Several states are together. I can't tell you all of the states that are included in the consortium. Yeah, so several states that are part of the consortium came together to, thank you so much, Richard, came together to look at standards for English language learners and to improve curriculum and instruction for English language learners. And those, thank you so much, Richard. And when they developed these standards, they have performance definitions. I'm going to show you an example. I don't expect you to be able to see this, but I'm going to highlight some of the differences. And this is, the reason I want to highlight this is when we get to the data of how our students did between 2014 and 2015, you can see how much content and the skills that they need to develop to go from one level to the next. So in the standards, assess a student's ability to use vocabulary, to use conventions, and the kind of linguistic complexity that they bring to reading and writing and speaking tasks. So at level one, they're just using words, phrases, chunks of language, or single words to represent ideas. And by the time they get to level five, they can use multiple complex sentences. They can express their ideas in an organized, cohesive, and coherent way. And then when they're at level six, they're getting technically at level five, our students can, level five overall, can exit out of the ELL program. But at level six means that they've met all of these criteria. And when we get to the testing, or we can say this now, when students are assessed, they're assessed in their ability to, their input and their output skills. So writing and speaking, reading and listening. And they're assessed in several domains, and then they achieve an overall score, with the highest score being six on ACCESS. And again, that will be important when you look at some of our data. And so just to get a sense of, we have a very small program here at Hadley, and you will be introduced to the queen of our program, Ms. Celine Desai. And she's going to talk a little bit about some of the students in the program, or just in general, not in specifics. But so we have, this is a percentage of our total enrollment. And you can see statewide, we're much lower than that enrollment statewide. But certainly enough to keep us occupied. This is a total number of students. So again, a small program, we have one full-time teacher certified to teach English as a second language.
Working in both schools?
You're working in both schools. So you can see, I'm going to let Celine talk about a little bit about her background. Also, we have students, we have 14 students in the program. They speak a variety of languages, Spanish, Urdu, Vietnamese, French, many languages. And Celine, I want you to have a chance to introduce yourself to everybody here.
So I'm going to stay right here. Everybody can hear me and see me more comfortable that way. I'm originally from Switzerland. So I moved here in 1988. My family relocated to the United States and lived in Massachusetts for a number of years. I went to UMass as an undergrad. And then once I graduated from UMass, I went to the University of Pennsylvania for my graduate degree in elementary education. And at that point, I had never even thought of doing English as a second language. I just loved kids and I wanted to be a teacher. Then I moved to Colorado because skiing is my passion and I love the mountains, being from Switzerland, that makes sense. So I moved to Colorado and lived there. But then once our girls were born, we decided to move back. So my teaching career started in Denver, Colorado. And Denver has a very large Hispanic population. So I started working there in a bilingual program, but I was solely teaching English. And then when we relocated, I started working in Holyoke, which, as I'm sure you're very aware, is also hugely Latino and has a very, very, I think they are at, well, the school where I was 98% Hispanic and below the poverty level. So a very difficult and interesting district to be teaching in, to say the least. And that's actually where I started really having an interest in working with ELL students, because all of my students there were ELL, but the classrooms are just general classrooms. So I kind of fell in love with these students from different parts of the world and could relate, obviously, because my first language is French, so I had been in ELL, or am, I guess. I'm still learning. Yeah, I'm ELL. And anyways, to make a long story short, that's where I started really enjoying teaching ELL students and decided to pursue an ELL degree so that I, you know, certified so I could teach ELL. And now I've been here for, I think it's my seventh. I have to check. What did I say here? My seventh year in Hadley. And I'm loving it. I really, again, we have students from, it's actually much more diverse than Holyoke, because Holyoke was really mostly Puerto Rican. And here we have students from Vietnam, the Ivory Coast. One just moved from Ecuador, so our number's actually up to 15 again. And we have just students from all over the world. It's been really, really interesting. And I enjoy being close to the families and helping them out as well. So that's my part of it.
Celine's, Ms. Tassati's love of her subject of teaching English language learners and her love of students is so evident when you go into her classroom, a place I really like to go. And certainly the outcomes that the students in her program have achieved are just mind-boggling. So this is just an overall, what is access? And access is something, we used to do something called MEPA, and all these great words in education. And then beginning in 2012-2013, we moved to access. So what do we see? These are students, obviously no names, the letters across the top here. And then the darker green is a 2014 score. Remember I said to you they go from really 0 or below 1 to 6. And what was happening in 2014, and then what's happening in 2015, excuse me. And as somebody, a lot of folks in the district, and certainly the children at Hopkins know, anyone who speaks French knows, I desperately try to improve my French all the time, as Jenny can attest to. It's really hard to acquire a second language. So any growth is miraculous if you've attempted this. And in some cases, we see students who went from levels like 4.3 to 6. So they jumped almost 2 entire levels in 1 year. And to drive home how really remarkable that is in terms of growth, I mean, that's just remarkable. So this is their student growth percentiles. And Heather, you spend a lot of time with this at work, right, to some degree. So I'm sure all of you can appreciate, I'm going to show you percentage-wise how frequently schools usually find that their SGP in the aggregate for a school, percentages of schools where these usually fall. But extremely high growth is anything over 80. We are expecting students to have growth between 40 and 60. Between 60 and 79, that's considered high growth. Anything over 80 is very high growth. She has no students who had low growth or very low growth. And 99, 99, 97, 98, 89. So you've gotten used to this now in school committee presentations. I get a little excited about data. I could just sit here and say, holy guacamole. That is just amazing. Just really something. And so at the state, I said when you look at schools, this isn't an ELL program, but this is typically when you look at percentage of schools with aggregate SGP. Usually you have about 1% on either end, and about 20% low, or that should have said low and very low, sorry, lower or high, and about 58% at moderate. That's usually how things fall out statewide for schools. And how they fall out for the students in Hadley in the ELL program, we have no students at low or very low. And we have 15% of our students where about 58% end up in the state. But where only 1% ends up in the state, that's 39% of the students that Ms. Desadi worked with last year who tested on access, who had comparable scores from one year to the next. 46% high growth, 39% of the students in very high growth. And those are just those two next to each other because I could not get enough of it, clearly. And so it's comparing them right next to each other. And that, I believe, is the overview. And certainly, if the committee has any questions, I really wanted the opportunity to acknowledge the hard work of the students and to acknowledge the work of Ms. Desadi in that program. It's just truly, truly remarkable. So I'm so grateful for all you do for our students. Just amazing. And very impressed with the work of the students. So I don't know if there are any questions.
Students are pulled out, but most of the time they're in their regular classrooms?
Correct. And you can certainly speak to, there's federal guidelines and state guidelines that dictate that.
So depending on their level, they get either a 45-minute block. If they're in the 1-2 level, then they get 45 minutes a day. And then if they're at level 3, 4, and 5, they get, if they're at level 1 and 2, they get 2 blocks a day. So they get 2 45-minute periods. And then if they're at level 3, 4, and 5, they get 1 45-minute period a day. So they're all pull-outs, and it's all daily.
But Hadley has an unusual number of teachers who have completed their certification in ELL.
Correct. And I'm sorry, I went through a lot of the wordy slides rather quickly there. But so all content area teachers must complete something called a sheltered English instruction endorsement, and anyone who supervises a teacher, a content area teacher who has an English language learner in his or her class. So our teachers we're almost at 100% completion of SEI endorsement. It's a requirement for licensure now. Yes.
Those are very impressive numbers. If there's one thing we could do to help you be even more effective, what would that be?
Oh, well, thank you. Actually, one thing that's been of huge help is the money that was raised by Helping Hearts, because I just received a big portion where we are purchasing a new intervention program that I'm very excited about. So that, for now, is I'm really, honestly, very excited. Most of that program is done on computers. There's a 45-minute intervention that's teacher-taught, so that will be me, and then there's a 45-minute that is independent instruction time on the computer. And so I know that Chromebooks are always kind of being fought for in the schools, at both the elementary and, you know, in a nice way, but, I mean, we need more. So I guess the one next step would be to have my own laptop computers so that the students always have one and they don't have to, it doesn't have to be dependent on whether there's a free Chromebook in the library. And right now what I'm doing when I need a computer, because I can never be sure that there's going to be one, is I take mine, so I have my own computer, but then, well, the school computer, and then I have one extra Chromebook, and I take that back and forth to make sure I have it. But it certainly would be nice to have, you know, even just 3 here and 3 at the elementary school that I knew were always there for my students to use. So thank you for asking that.
Sure. We're writing it down, Chris.
This is exciting news for the kids themselves. To see such great progress, and also from, I imagine that overall our school's picture should look pretty good over time if this keeps up, right? This is the gap in terms of high risk or low income or English language learners determines our level.
In terms of accountability, although one thing to be clear about is that the scores that you saw in SGP was specific to Access, and Access only assesses English language proficiency and development. So the students still take MCAS. I had some MCAS slides in there, and I didn't keep the MCAS slides because the percentage comparisons, it's such a small group of students, so I limited it to Access. They did do well, and we saw some great improvements from 2014 to 2015. And so yes, it will help us, but I just want to make sure that folks are clear that this is distinct from their MCAS score. So they might be, if a student moved from a one, even an entire level, so one, we saw some students who started in one up there and they were in the high twos, that would still be a huge challenge when it comes to MCAS. Right, if you saw that you're trying to get to six is where really you're completely proficient and ready to be assessed on content, but it
so
will
it
help.
May not be apples to apples, but mm-hmm. It's going in the right direction.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Selena.
Great presentation.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Nature's Classroom Field Trip.
Mr. Burgess. So this is in your packet.
Yes.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you guys tonight?
Great.
I am Mike Burgess. Nice to see all of you. I don't really know what to do, so should I just give you an overview of the trip?
Yes.
So I'm here to propose another outing to Nature's Classrooms for the seventh grade this year. And we've done it several years in the past. I've been here for 3.5 years, and this will be our fourth year going. And I've gone with other programs as well. I was in Belchertown for several years and used to go with their fourth grade. And I just can't speak highly enough of the Nature's Classroom program and what it does for kids. I was actually thinking about it. I went on a hike before I came here today. And I was like, it's kind of like we bring the kids back to the 80s as far as what they have to like play with and like no technology, and they have to like really communicate with each other and figure things out.
Do they have
out.
To wear shoulder pads?
They don't have to wear shoulder pads, but neon colors are in again, so
that's
it actually
true.
Kind of balances out a little bit.
They get their pants and their hair gets bigger immediately.
But for some of them it does due to the humidity, so you know, you never know. But it's a phenomenal trip. The chance the kids get to do some hands-on learning and really explore things. And even for a kid that's maybe doesn't love the academic world of writing and reading and really having to delve into things that way and they're more hands-on, it's just an amazing experience as far as what they get to do. And everything ties in with anything that we're working on at school, whether it's science, English language arts, geography. A lot of times there's multiple tie-ins as far as one single activity. And I just, like I said, I can't say enough about it. Even the facilities are wonderful. They don't have to go to the bathroom outside in an outhouse, although I tell them that for like the first, you know, 3 or 4 months we're talking about it, and they find out, they're like, oh my God, it's so nice here. The food's amazing. And the staff is super competent. You know, everybody that's there, they're highly educated. They know what they're talking about. We get to be along with them the entire time and experience it. I love going on either field groups, which are kind of more like team building and more informal exploration activities, as well as their actual classes where they learn about camouflaging, you know, as animals, and survival skills as far as their natural attributes, and rocketry and everything else that they get to do, hot air balloons they did last year, which was kind of rainy and it was crazy to try and make these hot air balloons go up in the air and the drizzle. As everybody's, you know, cowering for warmth and trying to get these things not to just like fold over on the ground. And then the social experience, I think, is probably what I think is the highlight of the whole trip, because they really have to learn how to help each other out. It's awesome to watch them eat dinner together and talk to kids in a way that, you know, you don't normally get to see them, and helping each other out, and just things that sometimes in the structure of the classroom we don't get to focus as much on, but they're just as important to their education in being able to be a member of society that can function well and help other people out. So details, I don't know if you guys need any details, but Ms. Duncan gave me her notes June 6th through the 8th are our dates this year. It's in Wakefield, Rhode Island, the facility we've used in the past, and it's always amazing there. It's immaculate. The estimated cost currently is $290, but we are going to be doing some fundraising. We have one definite fundraiser we'll do, which is popcorn, which we've done in the past, and it's a nice way to kind of chip away at that busing cost a little bit and make it a little more affordable. I mean, if we could do it for free, we would. And then Susan is researching another fundraiser that we're gonna try to do, and that has to do with recycling. I think it's called TerraCycling or something like that. She told me about it over the phone. She had a real raspy voice today, so it was kind of hard to understand her. But so she said she's gonna get some more details on that, and hopefully two decent fundraisers. The popcorn geared more at taking down the cost of the entire trip for everybody, and the TerraCycling, if we get that going, I think she's trying to aim that to try and be more a little student-centric. So if there are kids that, you know, need a little extra help, they can kind of drive at it a little bit more and get that cost chipped down a little bit more, so that, you know, I mean, the bottom line is we don't want the affordability of the trip to ever be, you know, something that's going to stop a kid from going. It's one thing if there's other circumstances, but and I don't know if you guys have any questions, comments, or concerns.
I'll just add that I know one of the things besides the cost of the trip that we always consider here when we get these requests is the tie-in to the curriculum. And a couple of us attended the parents' meeting last week, and I was just so impressed with the range of activities and how each one of those tied into a different part of the curriculum.
And just in the problem solving that they do too on a daily basis, I agree with you 100%. It's awesome.
Yeah. So that's impressive.
Thanks for the write-up that goes through that.
I wish that I could take credit for
just
it.
Susan Duncan.
I can tell you from Noah's perspective, and he's one of those kids who's, you know, who'd much prefer to be outside than in the classroom. He loved it and learned so much. So thank you for continuing to provide that.
Oh, of course. I'd do it all year long if we could. It's absolutely amazing.
Mike's one of those teachers who'd much rather be outside of the classroom.
Oh, yeah,
than in the classroom.
Oh, definitely. All right, well, thank you guys.
Thank you.
Motion for approval?
Motion to approve the Nature's Classroom field trip.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.
I think if I didn't approve it, my seventh grader wouldn't let me go home.
That's right.
Well, thank you so much, Mr. Burgess.
And, you know, you want to be home for Thanksgiving.
That's right.
School improvement plans.
Yes.
Pass and ha.
So in your packet, you have, before the school improvement plans, you have, mine's in a different order, so I'll do both. The progress report for district strategy. Last month, you said that you appreciated those updates, so I've continued that. And one of the things that's listed there is our school improvement plans. Now, typically, the school committee doesn't approve school improvement plans, but I certainly wanted you to have information about each school improvement plan. And Mr. Udall and Mr. Beck did a really great job of making sure their plans, you probably noticed, are aligned to the district strategy document that the school committee put together. So, one, I would ask, do you have any questions about the progress report on district strategy? And again, there's not a lot because I was putting together the packet about 2 weeks after you got the last one, since our meetings.
Yes, right.
If you're good with that, then I will allow Mr. Udall to answer any questions on Hadley Elementary School strategy document. Again, purposefully aligned with the district strategy. That's why it's redundant in terms of the purpose, the vision, the expectation, and the objectives. And then what he's done is identify those priorities where they're really focusing their efforts at Hadley Elementary. So the strategic priorities above each bullet are directly from the district strategy document, and then how Hadley Elementary is focusing on those. You can see there's a very big emphasis on tiered systems of support and positive behavioral interventions and supports, and providing teachers opportunities to collect and analyze data collaboratively in order to make adjustments to instruction and instructional groupings.
And MTSS means what?
Massachusetts System of Tiered Instruction.
Tiered System of Support.
Sorry,
MTSS, yeah. RTI is the response to intervention. Sorry.
Massachusetts Tiered Systems of Support.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Any questions or, okay. Very nice job, Mr. Udall. And then Mr. Bex, for Hopkins Academy, the school improvement plan is also included. Because Hopkins will be going through NEASC accreditation beginning in 2017. Is that when the visit is?
Didn't we just go through that?
2007, 2008.
Okay. Wow.
So, Mr. Beck aligned. Mr. Beck identified goals, his school improvement goals, the dates, and his action plan. This also is part of there, as you saw, the example of Jeff's educator evaluation goals, his own personal goals, the action plan and dates, that follows the educator evaluation format. So that's part of the plan. The products are how he'll measure progress. And then the alignment is, he lists the alignment, sorry, because it went longer, it should be kind of on larger paper, but he aligns it to the district strategy, so he takes the exact goals and priorities, the objectives and priorities from the district strategy. He has aligned each goal to the admin evaluation indicators and to the NEASC standards.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
This is page 2, faculty release of core values, beliefs, and learning expectations.
In 2012, the school as a school community is required as part of the accreditation process to establish a set of core values, beliefs, and measurable learning expectations.
Okay.
And it's the faculty's responsibility to do that. They need to take input from all stakeholders in the community. But the idea of that is to have the faculty own those expectations at the core of what it is that we do. So we'll be re-engaging in that process. We've had an ongoing process of review here that just finished in 2012, but we need to become current with the new standards. And it's a good opportunity for us to do to take multiple looks at what it is that we do here at school.
Mm-hmm.
And we have some students trained to lead the foray of pulling folks in from the community to give their input. So,
thank you.
Any other questions about either of the improvement plans or the district strategy document?
Thank you for doing it.
Yes, thank you.
We're over here.
I know. It's just.
It's our idea.
Actually, is this? Are we done with this room?
Yeah.
Okay. That would just be awesome.
Okay.
Where are we?
Public comment.
Well,
do we have to do public comment? Did I put this out of order somehow?
No, I think public. Are you going to talk at all about what did the Board of Education decide about Park versus MCAS?
Oh, I was going to, yes. So I had assessments. I was going to do that under school committee things. We can do that now. Also, do you want to do that?
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Okay. So on Tuesday the 17th, the Board of Education voted to go with MCAS 2.0, which is a Park-like assessment that is expected to be fully implemented in the spring of 2017 test administration. I will say that there is a great deal of skepticism among many people about the likelihood. That seems like a tall order. It seems like a very tall order to, all right, let me back up. So the board voted on the 17th to go with this new assessment. The state will put out a request for proposals in January. They will undoubtedly wait until after the board has voted on whether or not to adopt the new science standards. The belief is most people expect the state will adopt the new science standards that have been out for public comment for almost 2 years now. Because they want the requests for proposals, or that they want anyone who's offering to build the test to be able to build the test for science, to be able to build the test entirely, they won't put the proposal out until after they've had the vote in January. So for a spring administration, that leaves them 18 months, less than 18 months, to get somebody who can build the test. So they'll have to adhere to all the timelines. I'm saying all that to say that's why many people believe this is very ambitious. That's when they put the specs out, in January. They're going to have them out for probably at least 30, if not 45 days. And then they'll close, they'll award. So really, they've given themselves a year. The vendor has a year to build a test. But they have said that they anticipate the test will be operational in 2017. One thing is that they do want the test to be an online test and expect that districts will administer the assessment entirely online in 2019, all districts in the Commonwealth. The expectation is new test in 2017, everybody's online in 2019, and the class of 2019 will be the first class that will be, through the class of 2019 now, we're still doing MCATs, and then we'll move on to the next test, graduating class, as a graduation competency determination. What school districts need to decide now is that for spring of 2016, school committees may elect, if you were a district that gave MCATs,
that's this spring.
Like us, if you gave MCATs, then you have a choice. You may give PARC or you may give MCATs. The commissioner has said that the MCAS administration in 2016, this coming spring, will have several PARC-like items or PARC items on it. So it will make comparing results easier and also provide students some exposure to PARC-like items.
Who's developing that test?
So they'll take the existing, because all districts who did PARC last year must do PARC this year. The only districts that have an option are districts like Hadley that elected to do MCAS last year. You could choose to do PARC this year and then do MCAS 2.0 in 2017. And PARC in...
To be held harmless.
Right. So that question of why, really a general question, why would any district make that choice? We talked about this a great deal at a superintendent's meeting I was at this week, and there are many districts, it was almost a 50-50 split in the state. Many districts elected to go with MCAS in spring of 2015, last spring. So while someone said, well, would we want to do that to better prepare our students, the board didn't adopt PARC.
Right.
So that's not the test they adopted. It's not for preparation, it's for the point that Roby made. If the district goes to PARC, the district is held harmless for accountability purposes.
What's that mean?
That means that if there are any consequences for a level redesignation. So if you drop from a level 2 to a level 3, a level 3 to a level 4, that you wouldn't suffer any consequences. Although the commissioner still says that he can place a district in level 5, regardless of what you choose. So you would be held harmless, although the accountability data are published. They'll
right.
be public in December, so it's not like the data are published, but the district would be held harmless. So if a district were concerned their data.
Only the districts that switch from MCAS to PARC are held harmless?
No, all the PARC.
All the PARC districts.
All the PARC districts.
All the PARC districts are held harmless. So that would be the carrot that would incentivize districts to do that.
And we have to make this decision by when?
We need to inform, I just found out in an email today, that we need to inform the state by December 18th. So we could request, we would either have to hold another
school
tonight or hold another meeting, or hold another meeting between now and then, or put in a request due to extenuating circumstances, although I don't know that they would give us until the end of January to decide.
I think the question also is whether the district is really ready to administer PARC. Technologically.
You still have a paper pencil option. There's a bigger question there, Roby, you're right, in terms of budget planning,
right.
Capital acquisition. 2019 is non-negotiable.
Right.
For this coming spring, districts could still elect PARC paper pencil or PARC online.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, and certainly I think the administration, we've talked about this, we actually like looking at our data, we like comparing mm-hmm. apples to apples. That's valuable to us. So we don't have any desire to be held harmless for any reason. We actually want to see what the data
but
are.
But you can't do an apples to apples if the test is starting to hybridize, right?
We don't know exactly what there will be, but it should be not that different that we can still compare results from last year, this year, and in spring 2016. And that's the thing that I can't see for going, moving to Park for 1 year when we're going to be moving to MCAS 2.0 the following year. You know, if we were to do Park in our district, then we're not going to be able to make that comparison. And as Dr. McKenzie has said, you know, we'd like to be able to compare our data and see where areas of improvement are from 1 year to the next, so that we can also identify the areas that we need to focus on for the upcoming year as well.
And I assume we don't know the answer to this, that MCAS 2.0, the ability to do a comparison from year to year to year, we don't know how different MCAS 2.0 will be to know if, right?
We don't. They've done a very a good job. I have to give the department a lot of credit. They invested a lot of time in equating park scores. They spent a tremendous amount of time in being able to, so districts could do that. So I imagine we will have the ability, but it certainly, it'll be a change. I mean, we'll have to take that into consideration, and many districts noticed statewide, they noticed when students took the test online, those students who took Park online did worse than students who took a paper and pencil version of Park. So there'll be many things. The first time we look at the test data for the new test, there'll be things.
Why? Because it's like the first time they've done an online test?
Keyboarding, and also Park is a timed test.
Yeah, and that's a big concern, because kids that are not taught keyboarding skills, mm-hmm. and kids that take a longer time to process things are going to be limited in their success until we get more training for word processing. Mm-hmm. And also kids that need longer periods of time to complete anything handwritten, let alone this, or you have to get those skills built up pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm. So there are some word processing skills, certainly the timing, and also using some of the kind of widgets or gadgets that you need to use for math, so it's not only just typing and expressive language possession, manipulating the code.
We currently do not have the technology or bandwidth to do an online test, is that
we
true?
Could. We could. We have a much larger testing window.
As long as it's working.
What?
As long as it's working.
As long as it's working. You have a much larger testing window. So in terms of our infrastructure and in terms of our hardware, it means that computers would not be available for other instructional purposes during the testing window, and Park gives you a large testing window. So we have the equipment to do it. In terms of HR capacity, that's where we could run into some problems. We have one network administrator. We have one tech person, hardware person. And I do know of a district that said they ran into a lot of problems because Chromebooks or Google, they changed something, which they're allowed to do, right the day before, the night before they were administering all the Chromebooks. So these updates occurred that interfered with their ability to do the test. And they had a large enough testing window, but they were scrambling that morning trying to figure out what happened. So that's where we would run into trouble, is our HR capacity to race in and fix things. It's time, and to make sure the affective filter that kids are feeling confident.
But I feel like you're almost making an argument that we try to go online this year so that we aren't bound in 2017. At least we have a test year
to see what happens. So if I understand this correctly, too, and this is, I don't want to misspeak, but Mike Duffy has indicated, too, that we have to program the laptops and Googles during that window so that only that child or those children that are using that particular laptop or Chromebook can access it during that testing period or during that window. So in other words, all of our
CAL book.
Yes. Well, you have more time to prepare for it.
Yeah. So our CAL units and the units that are in the two labs are not going to be accessible to anybody else. Mm-hmm. They would have to be accessible during that period only to the grades that are going to be testing.
And it's 2019 that everybody has to be on.
Online is 2019.
No, 2017. But starting 2017, we're bound by the results. No, if we
right.
So there is some argument to take the leap in 2016, try to do it online, so that we know what the technological issues are.
I think there's too much.
I don't really want to do this. I totally sense the panic in your face, Pat.
Well, it's not even just technology is one issue, but we had a conversation in the elementary school last week about our writing curriculum, because people are identifying gaps in it, and one of the things that came up repeatedly, and it's a serious issue, is they do not get keyboarding instruction. It is not part of the general, and there's no place to put it in the week even, as well as people are trying to juggle so many responsibilities. So that is a big concern for them, to go to an online version of any test. So whether it's 2.0 or MCAS or PARC, that's sort of secondary to that particular problem.
And one of the other concerns is that there needs to be a greater alignment, and we talked about this as a faculty at Hopkins, there needs to be a greater alignment between what we do in classroom assessments as well, so that students are not unfamiliar with the testing environment and the testing model. And while we do have some online assessments, they're typically formative assessments, and you know, not the kind that have this level of stakes with them. So we need to make some adaptations to our instructional assessment model, and that's going to take a little bit of professional development on our part. And we've had some people who have gone out and done some professional development to be able to get feedback on what those changes might need to be. So to have the opportunity to implement that, from my perspective, and waiting a year to do so, I think would give us the chance to put some of those in place over the course of this year and into next school year.
Yeah, I think so.
Can I add something? I also really think that students have this relationship with screens that is very immediate and impulsive and quick, and it's, you know, they click, they text, they click send. The whole idea of doing a test and editing, I think it's going to take some education to the students of what is the difference between texting and completing a high-stakes test on a computer. And for that reason alone, as a parent, I would want as much time as possible to educate the students, to teach them that skill.
But not that much time, because this train is coming to that station, and we're going to need to be prepared sooner rather than later. So I imagine holding our feet to the fire
is just far. It's just asking too much of the faculty and the students.
Right, but and like having a year.
Sure,
and to do that.
I would also think that a possible downside. So if we were to say, oh, let's switch to PARC and go online and see what the bugs are in this coming spring of 2016. One of the things we won't get is we won't get the advantage of solving this problem with others. So what's going to happen is our districts are, and MASC and MASS are really going to hold the commissioner's feet to the fire around what kind of support will you be providing districts, particularly smaller low capacity districts. So my guess would be that many smaller districts won't race to test it out when it's going to change again, because it would just create a lot of pressure on a small district. Rather, once the new test is adopted, then perhaps not waiting until we have to, but once the new test is adopted, benefiting from the experience of other people, asking other small districts, how did you do this? Is the testing window large enough that we can share tech people during that time period? Right? So you have more than one man or woman racing around saying, I'm the only one here to solve the problem. So I think there'll be some creative solutions, perhaps, that we can explore also.
I don't see a compelling reason to switch at this point, but I think that this conversation has been valuable in bringing out points that need to be a priority looking ahead. But there's still so much unknown and things that may change that to switch only adds to that angst and everything. So I would stay constant.
And also keeping in mind the training piece, our staff are very adept, they're very smart. Other districts have figured this out. But remember, a switch to PARC is only 3-8 PARC.
Right.
So doing PARC in the spring means you do PARC, math, and English language arts for grades 3-8. You do science at all grades. You do MCAS at grade 10. And if you're a special ed alternate tester, you do MCAS. So there is no, I mean, you don't just do PARC. Switching to PARC means administering two tests is what it means.
I think we're ready to vote. I don't think we have to wait till December 18th.
Yeah. Okay.
Are we ready?
I make a motion to remain with MCAS for 2016 testing.
I'd second that.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Right. Thank you.
Ooh-hoo.
Thank you.
Ooh-hoo. I have no idea where we are.
The personnel report.
Oh,
this
thank
is
you.
Another discussion too. Just in general, Not, this is, we've received additional information since this personnel report was put together, but a general conversation for the committee. In terms of anticipated vacancies, does the committee, what is the will of the committee in terms of posting for vacancies? And the relationship with the budget is what I'm asking. So these are anticipated for fiscal year 17, and we haven't had formal conversation about the budget. If we know that we have positions where people have indicated to us that they're resigning from the position, they're moving on, we know somebody is retiring.
What kind of positions are we talking about? Are we talking about teaching?
We are talking about teaching, talking about school psychology.
Start advertising for those right away. We're not going to cut any teaching staff next year.
Well, that really has to come from the committee. That's why I'm asking that question.
It would be our goal to not cut teaching staff.
Yeah, we stay pretty constant with that, and I think to be able to post it sooner rather than later gets folks in the spring, that early spring,
right,
the option, and may at least broaden the pool of candidates that we'd be able to draw to a position.
And a small technical question, I'm splitting hairs on semantics. Would you like us to post for anticipated openings or simply openings?
I think to be safe, we say anticipated.
If we have a resignation in hand, however, that is definitely...
Well, I think it's a case of what if town meeting doesn't pass the budget?
It's not the resignation.
Right.
It's
and then it may be that we would not, the way we would deal with that would be to not hire a new position rather than hire than cut.
I can't think of a teaching position that's not essential in the school district.
Therefore, we would hire.
I just can't. Having had kids go through the district, Hopkins can't lose any faculty. The elementary school. I mean, if the numbers went down, maybe you would need one less elementary school teacher. But
we've lost two in the last 3 years at the elementary because we've had two classes that had three classes in it have moved up. And we could have very well used those positions to offset some of the issues we're dealing with now. Mm-hmm. Certainly don't want to lose any additional teachers to elementary.
You can talk me out of it. It seems...
I understand what you're saying. I don't have an objection to that, but I just...
So the downside
of... I think I'm clear about kids can't touch teaching staff and have a cool school district that remains viable and vibrant.
Are we saying the same thing? I'm not sure that I'm following. You're saying if we there are some vacancies coming up, and there are some anticipated vacancies.
Mm-hmm. So and people have given us intent to retire.
Yeah. And you're agreeing that we should advertise for them because we cannot do without them.
So is it the terminology?
No, I think it's the terminology.
Question.
Promising the hire, or are we saying we expect to have hires until we have a budget?
Which may change what candidates you get for those positions.
Right.
If they aren't confident that they're going to have a spot.
And what's the risk? Is we advertise it as an opening and then we actually can't follow through?
And I think it's really, I mean, speaking quite plainly, it's also, you have more context in terms of the town and the budget and more history with this. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to create a problem by posting a position and having there be any sort of questions in terms of how can one have positions when they don't have a budget that's been approved or even
But you're not creating new positions.
Correct.
Right. You're filling existing positions. I think there's a big difference in the town.
Okay. So that's
I'm willing to
really
argue
more.
That
okay, that's really more where I was coming from. Is there any
is
degree
that
of presumption?
To go to a tri-board meeting?
That was the volunteer.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Then we're promising you.
Okay. Fantastic.
So we're not using the word anticipate.
We are not anymore because Roby's going to go fight it with the tri-board.
Fantastic.
And the swan.
That's right.
Swan announced.
That's right.
All right.
Oh, yeah. That.
Chris, I don't know if you heard all the technology discussion.
No, I did not. Okay, so we have a few reports here. I apologize, actually, for the expense report. I got a call from Sue asking if I wanted to run a new expense report last Tuesday to put in your package, or if I wanted to use the one I ran Monday that I send out to everyone. And I said, well, one day, probably not even any purchase orders. You can go ahead and just use that one. And it wasn't until today when I went to print out the meeting package and I said, 42 pages? What do they have?
Yeah, I wondered that too. It just kept going.
It's because 29 of them are mine just for this report, so I apologize. So you've got a slightly different report that's a little more detailed, but probably not to the extent you wanted it. So, and after using all those pages up, really there's not a lot to talk about. So that's the other part of it. Again, spending is going as expected. Really just not a lot to even talk about in that report, which, again, knowing me.
That's great, Chris. Yes.
That's I suppose, a good thing to hear.
Yes.
So, if you guys have any questions, you can certainly ask and I can answer them.
No, there was a lot of detail.
And I want to make sure, Chris, on the revolving accounts report, that I put the right one in here. So
you did.
Okay.
And that would be the next kind of explanation I have here. You do have the revolving accounts report. You can see that a couple of them are blank for September and October. We had the changeover to the new town accountant, and so I never got the September numbers from them for your October report. So I requested from him, I need September 30th and October 31st balances. You can see a couple of them I got here. The lunch one, I'm not sure what went on there. I'm wondering if they just didn't deposit the money from the state yet that we got. So that one's a little suspect. But then for preschool, I got the ambulance fund.
Oh, how's that looking?
A-okay.
Excellent.
But not for the preschool account. It's a little bit less than that. And the student activity, I also got a different account. So we have gone back and forth several times with this. At this point in time, I'm actually looking next Wednesday to switch my days, Wednesday and Thursday. Come here on Wednesday when he is here and essentially spend the day with him to go over a number of things that we have, including just setting this up so I can get these things once a month from him. And make sure, you know, they're the correct accounts we need. We're also going to be doing some work with the grants accounts at the town hall. That's been, I guess, for lack of a better term, quite messy for some time now. Just the account names made no sense with the grants. He did rename them. Now we're looking to go back and move any money around that has come in and had been put in incorrect accounts. And we know that that's happened because the treasurer would email me and say, I put it in this account, it was my best guess. And I would write back, no, that's not the one it goes in. And it just made no sense with the name, so it wasn't her fault. But we're going to move that money back out and essentially straighten it out at the town hall so we can match up our accounts with theirs. They're okay at our in our general ledger. So that's where we are. So this report will be full next month, including the preschool and student activity, but unfortunately you won't get the ambulance fund balance, so I apologize for that.
Do you know if this accounting company, are we the only town they do that's got a single town school district?
That I don't know. I can ask them next week. We already set it up that I will switch days and come and spend the day with him, so he knows I'm coming. I can certainly ask him.
I don't know, maybe we are new and different.
Well, there are a number of things that need to be addressed and probably had to have for quite some time, so I know he's working on cleaning up a number of things.
Chris, a quick question. Sure. One of the prior meetings we voted to establish a school fund, right, that was going to be tracked between the two different schools. Will that show up on the revolving accounts report or on a different?
It can. If you wanted to.
Is that an easy way to put it? I think we had wanted to at least know what the balance was.
In each school?
Between the two schools, yeah.
Yeah, you can do that.
Okay. So currently, as the account sits, as the current report reads, an account like that would be under student activity, right? It'd be lumped in there. So this one would be, you would want this separated out, which is
so it's a subset of the student activity?
Right. I just wanted to, I didn't know if you realized when you're looking at the student activity balance, that includes all student activity funds. So that'll be this evening. Chris will need us to set up a student activity fund for Diversity Club. So that'll be something we need to do. But all, I can't even think of all of them now. Nature's Classroom will be in there, all the money we deposit from that. Europe trips, anytime we're collecting money.
Yeah.
So we could certainly add another column for the gift accounts or the
Yeah, that's not a problem at all. I can certainly do that.
Great, thanks.
Yeah. So again, you know, we'll have that one fully filled in for your next meeting. And the last report I have are the grant reports. You can basically see the amounts that we've been awarded and the amounts that have been used so far. A couple of the grants, we haven't gotten the award amounts yet, and so therefore we have no spending in those areas either. And I emailed tonight the administrators of those accounts just to see if they have heard anything at all about them. So, you know, hopefully we can get the amounts quickly on them. And I did not do the transfers. I had mentioned how some expenses went to the general budget instead of to the grants until we got the money. I haven't done those transfers yet because they have to be done also at the town level. And I thought just waiting until the two of us sat down, we could kind of do it together and avoid any kind of possible communication mix-ups or something. So they will be done next week instead of taking the chance, basically, that something might not get done correctly. So that'll be addressed as well. Yeah, we'll be good going forward.
We're undergoing our audit right now, and our auditor has talked to us about new federal reporting requirements that are going to be pretty onerous. Will the schools be impacted by that? Do you know?
You know, I don't at the moment. I can certainly look into that and see if we're looking at a lot more in that area. I can't really think. I mean, you know, unless it's the federal grant level stuff,
where it is.
They're going to be markedly different than what we've had. Typically, those grant reports are pretty straightforward. So, I mean, almost really, it's now it's a question of here's what you budgeted, how much did you spend, and
right.
You just kind of, I mean, it's literally a 30-second report because we spend our grants fully every year, so it's, you know, it's really just a matter of looking it up.
I think it's mostly sub-recipients. If we don't have any sub-recipients, then...
Oh, well, then, you know, we may be all set with that.
Right.
Okay. But I'll look into it anyway and just let you know. Again, because the reports were so simple before, it might be, they might be looking for a little more detail, but really, you know, I don't expect it to be something that we, you know, would struggle with or anything.
Any other questions for Chris? Are you leaving or staying?
I'm staying.
Okay.
Thank you.
Look here, Linda Dunleavy, Statewide Assessment Spring 2016. Sorry, I didn't see that on the agenda this afternoon.
Found time.
Policy Subcommittee, it did a first reading of the District Curriculum Accommodation Plan. So we need to, if there's any changes or corrections, if not, we need to close out our second reading and have an action to accept.
I have no questions or comments.
No. Motion? Was that a motion?
It wasn't. It was a statement. Motion. Motion to accept the revisions to the district curriculum accommodation plan.
Second it.
All in favor of that?
Aye.
Aye.
And then we need to also do the same thing to the elementary school handbook and the Hopkins handbook, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Could those be one motion? Those probably could just be one motion.
Yep. Motion to accept the changes to the Hopkins and Hadley Elementary School handbooks.
Mm-hmm. Seconded.
All in favor of that one?
Aye.
Aye.
Excellent. And I think I'm done with policy, aren't I?
Well,
yes.
Done.
Thank you. Look at that. I've just moved everything over.
Linda?
Yes, sir.
We forgot to do the Diversity Club.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm sorry.
Yes, Chris, go.
I
but
went
then
right
you didn't
into
leave.
Emailing about the federal grants, and all of a sudden, yeah, we forgot that. So basically, we just need your approval to open up the student activity account for the Diversity Club.
It's Diversity Club / Trained Bystanders, and that combined organization. And I'm very pleased to announce that the last Thursday night at the annual meeting, the Board of Trustees approved a request for $700 as a seed for that account. And so, if that account's approved, it will be populated with that money.
Nice.
To start.
Wow, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
very generous.
Do you have an advisor for that?
We do. Dan O'Donohue is actually the advisor for both groups, and we wanted to have students who were trained in facilitation also to do some of the leadership work out in the community, so we're combining a couple of those groups together with this fund.
Thanks.
Motion to approve the account creation for the Diversity Club of Safety.
I'll second that, and thank you to the trustees.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And we should also, just a global thank you to the trustees. I have, because Brian sent it over to me, I have the total amount that they...
Yeah, I was actually going to bring that in December, because there's a whole bunch of information that goes along with that.
Great.
I just happened to see this on tonight's and figured I'd mention that.
Yes, so you will have a detailed report of what they funded. We certainly do want to say now thank you so much to the Board of Trustees for their generosity.
Heather, Unit D.
Unit D negotiations continue. We have a couple meetings coming up this month. We are pretty much at the point of discussing the compensation package. And I think we have literally the next two Mondays our meetings.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Did Building and Grounds meet since our last?
No.
No, there's been some discussions. They're still trying to gather information on the sidelines. I think it needs a little shot in the arm.
Sidelines. Pricing.
Ah, that's right. And the lights at the field. Yeah. So, no.
Okay. And CES, Roby.
We successfully completed our audit for last year. Isn't it pretty?
Nice.
Yeah, we have some new auditors and they are concise.
That is really small.
Yeah. It's great. We have a new chair of the board after 16 years, and he's interested in being involved in advocacy for general issues in education. So the first issue we took up was charter schools and charter school cap legislation. And CES put together a great amount of information on enrollment trends in Western Massachusetts and who's going to charter schools and who's staying and everything. So if anybody wants to look at this, it's now part of the record. And the
is it online?
I could send it to you that way.
Yes, please.
And the steering committee of the superintendents met with Senator Dowling and Representative Kulik today to discuss how the differences in how charter schools affect the schools in Western Massachusetts as opposed to urban centers. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty interesting.
Yes. It's a good meeting today. It was very productive. The senator and the representative indicated that they did not believe that there would probably be a tremendous amount of legislative activity, although you would probably think differently based on the amount of newspaper articles, but they didn't foresee a tremendous amount of legislative activity. But they did assume that the activity would probably come from the ballot initiative that's out around having no caps on charter schools. So it's an interesting conversation.
I didn't know that was a ballot initiative.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Did we just finish?
I think we did. Did we get the essay out?
We did not. Mr. Beck.
I have one more item, and perhaps I missed the public comment period, but I just wanted to add that a number of students, led by leadership in the senior class, have signed a petition requesting that we engage basically in dialogue about the one colors for the gowns. And in speaking with the leadership from both GSA, who brought forward the proposal that was approved in October, as well as members of the senior class, they totally understand the decision. They just wanted to be able to have the conversation within school, and if they came up with an alternative proposal, have the opportunity to bring that before the school committee at the December 21st meeting. I indicated that I'd not only be happy to bring this forward, but to provide them with the opportunity to engage in the dialogue. So.
Mr. Beck, is it clear what our decision was?
Yes, it's in the minutes, and it's been made clear to the students, and will be made clear as part of the starting point of that discussion. So
okay, that's good, because I spoke to a few students who signed that petition, and they Before they signed it, they didn't have their correct decisions.
That's right. And yeah. And part of that's my fault because we haven't put out any information on graduation other than we did the measurements for caps and gowns, I think maybe the Thursday or Friday before, right around that time. And the next time that something would come up for graduation would be around the beginning of December when we'd have a formal conversation about that. So,
yeah.
But the students were open to having the dialogue, and I feel like it's really important for us to have that conversation in our school community. So.
I think that'd be great. I applaud them for wanting to have civil discourse on this. I mean, I think if they have different ideas on how to meet the objectives that we were intending to meet, that would be great.
Or that they arrived by themselves at the same conclusion that that you had arrived at through the proposal, which is mm-hmm. certainly a viable option, and that dialogue may bring everybody around to that point. So
that'd be great. So they're going to potentially come to our December meeting?
Yeah, we'll have representation, either a combination of the class officers and representatives from GSA who put forward the proposal, and hopefully they'd be putting forward something collaboratively if there was something that was different. So, because part of the requirement, and the leadership understands this, is that if they were to do something different than what's currently proposed, that there needs to be an assurance of no coercion. And even students in GSA with whom I spoke as recently as today felt like it's a school where students who are different with regard to gender issues and have really been protected at this school. And our student population certainly takes a great deal of pride in the peer relationships that are there with students and the level of comfort that's been built in coming forward and saying something if peers aren't able to deal with it themselves. And so they want to be able to keep that conversation going because they've done that work as a peer group. So.
Brian, historically, how has the decision been made to go with two colors instead of one? Because, I mean, I have heard from some graduating classes that have one color.
Yeah.
So obviously there was a switch somewhere.
This is in the time that I've been here, I've done really no historical research. I inherited several years of film to watch on graduation, and it had been white and blue. Mm-hmm. So I'm not immediately aware. I did have the opportunity when I recently chaired the accreditation team to know that this is not a local phenomenon. It's across Massachusetts that schools are dealing with this, some of them far less productively and civilly than our students are willing to do. And some schools have done some very interesting things. So there are some models out there, but we're all really appreciative of the fact that GSA brought forward this proposal because it does put us in a situation where we're taking action. And the thing that I liked about the response of the senior class was they're willing to take the lead in that and change that, but they just didn't want to be left out of the conversation. And so I thought the way that they presented it was really responsible, incredibly civil, and I trust them to be able to engage in that conversation and come up with something.
And I think, Paul, to your point, what's helpful is that some students were, as well as some parents, were under the impression that the school committee had selected a color. Mm-hmm. We were very clear.
Right. Yeah.
I have to go on record saying I'm just so hurt that my riveting minutes are clearly not read. They're available usually 24 hours after, folks, if you want to read them. I'd like to think they're interesting and everyone reads them, but I'm getting the impression they're not as interesting as I thought. I'll get over that.
Yes.
You could put a little thing. I sometimes do put a little sentence halfway through that says, if you're still reading, I'll give you a piece of chocolate. And see if anyone comes to your office. I always like it when people come to my office with their hand out. So our next meeting date is December 21st at 5:30. And the D subcommittee is going into executive session.
Yes.
How do we do that?
So you would adjourn regular session. Well, you would take, someone would need to move. We'll still do a roll call vote. A motion to go into executive session. The motion's written under number 13. Motion to go into executive session with, as it says, it should say, and not to reconvene. Sorry. Not to reconvene in open session.
For just you and Linda. Just
well, yes. You all are welcome, but it's only
so
required.
We don't have to be part of the vote.
That's
for executive session. We just have to close this meeting. And
that's what I thought.
Right.
Okay.
Can we close the meeting?
Motion to adjourn. Yeah, second.
Motion to adjourn.